Our next topic for discussion in the white lesion series is hereditary benign intraepithelial dyskeratosis, or Whitcomb-Vogt-Simons disease. Just like white sponge nevus, this disorder is also a genomic keratotic pathology or genetic mucosal or keratinopathy, presenting with lesions in the mouth, and in this case in particular, frequent ocular lesions as well. In fact, ocular involvement is the main clinical distinguishing factor between hereditary benign intraepithelial dyskeratosis and white sponge nevus. In this discussion, let us refer to the disorder using the eponym Whitcomb's disease, as you will notice that, though it is a better descriptive terminology, constantly repeating the term hereditary benign intraepithelial dyskeratosis can be quite a mouthful. So now, what I'm going to do now is to compare similarities between the two disorders, white sponge nevus and Whitcomb's disease, so that you know why it may sometimes be difficult to distinguish them based on clinical characteristics alone. Later on, I will touch on some important differences to help you pick one confidently over the other. So let's begin. First of all, both of these conditions are genetic mucosal cell disorders and exhibit an autosomal dominant pattern of inheritance, which basically means that the gene of interest here is located on one of the 22 pairs of non-sex chromosomes, and that an affected individual, whether male or female, has a 50% probability or 1 in 2 chance of passing down the disease to the offspring just by classical Mendelian genetics. However, this is frequently complicated by the variation in expression of the diseased gene and also by new sporadic mutations, so that in the first instance of variable expressivity, offsprings may only develop very subtle signs of the disease, and this may potentially go unnoticed, effectively being misconsidered as skipping a generation. Also, some features of the disease may manifest later on in life, and this is usually observed in disorders that are not lethal. Mutations or genetic anomalies that arise sporadically further contribute to this complication, because individuals with such new mutations do not have a family history. And a family history, as we all know, is an important clue that is frequently relied upon in diagnosing inherited disorders. Alright, moving on. The oral mucosa for both of these disorders is a primary site of occurrence, and these oral lesions are typically in a bilateral distribution, affecting mostly the buccal mucosa, lips, ventral tongue surface, and occasionally the floor of the mouth. Extraoral mucosal sites may be involved in both cases, but the two disorders do not exhibit skin manifestations. This will be in contradistinction to another pathology, that is follicular keratosis, which we will discuss in a separate presentation. It is a disorder which is also autosomal dominantly inherited, but unlike Whitcomb's and white sponge nevus, it is primarily characterized by cutaneous lesions. Now, finally, lesions in both conditions appear either at birth or in early childhood, with most cases being diagnosed before 20 years of age. The crucial difference I would now like you to note down is that whereas white sponge nevus may additionally and in fact frequently involve a number of extraoral mucosal sites, oropharyngeal, laryngeal, anogenital, vaginal, and rarely the conjunctiva, Whitcomb's disease limits its extraoral manifestation to just the ocular system, typically affecting the conjunctiva and the area surrounding the cornea. You will observe in a young child plaques of white gelatinous or granular tissue on the bulbar conjunctiva, and unlike in the intraoral lesions, these are frequently symptomatic, manifesting as chronic ocular irritations, feelings of foreign body sensations, conjunctival flushing, excess lacrimation, and even photophobia, sensitivity to light. These symptoms closely mimic some forms of allergic conditions, and it's even complicated by the observation that cases do worsen during the allergy months in the spring and summer, further confusing the symptoms with those of seasonal allergy. Indeed, people have likened it to one of the red eye diseases. When these symptoms become frequent and prolonged, they lead to extreme corneal and conjunctival vascularization that may potentially cause impairment of vision in the affected eye, or rather both eyes, since even in the eye, the lesions tend to occur bilaterally. So this lesion is characterized by bilateral oral mucosal involvement in a symmetric distribution and also bilateral ocular involvement. Now, frank blindness may occur if the plaques extend to completely obscure the corneal translucency. Another difference between the two disorders is obviously the underlying molecular pathology. We've discussed that white spontaneous results because of an autosomal dominant mutation in the helix domain of mucosa-specific keratin genes, keratin 4 and keratin 13. We've also mentioned that these mutations may be deletions or point mutations. For Whitcomb's disease, the genetic anomaly has been localized to the long arm of chromosome 4, in which a heterozygous duplication process takes place at the telomeric region, leading to a total of 3 alleles instead of 2, quite like a partial trisomy. Let me explain this to you in a little more detail, as simply as I can state. Here is a cardiogram demonstrating homologous pairs of human chromosomes, 22 autosomal pairs and 1 pair of sex chromosome, here identifying a male XY individual. Here is the X chromosome, and beside it is a much smaller Y chromosome. A normal female would demonstrate 2 X chromosomes and an absent Y chromosome. Females are females not because they have 2 X chromosomes, but because they do not have a Y chromosome. And males are males because they have a Y chromosome. Effectively, in the absence of a Y chromosome, an individual is programmed to develop as a female. Now, the autosomes, or non-sex chromosomes, are numbered from 1 through 22 in a decreasing order of size. In Whitcomb's disease, we are interested in chromosome number 4, the fourth largest chromosome, and being homologous means that one member of the pair comes from the mother and the other comes from the father, although both have the same structure and set of genes. On this schematic of chromosome 4, you can observe a constricted region or centromere that allows the identification of a short arm and a long arm. Genes that are closer to the centromere are referred to as proximal genes, and those further away or towards the ends, the telomere, are called distal genes or telomeric genes. Within this chromosomal structure, there are different loci or gene locations. In Whitcomb's disease, we are interested in this telomeric segment, 4Q35, on the long arm. This segment is duplicated or repeated twice in one of the chromosomes, so that you end up having 3 segments in total of this portion of the chromosome, 2 segments here and 1 segment from the normal chromosome in the homologous pair, giving rise to a partial or segmental trisomy. Being autosomal dominant means that by definition, you only require a heterozygous anomaly to manifest the full-fledged spectrum of the clinical features, though once again this may be influenced or obscured by variabilities in expression and degree of penetrance. Now, I would like us to pause now and think outside this topic for a bit and try to recollect another trisomic disorder that should be very familiar to you. In this disorder, rather than having segmental duplications, you instead have whole chromosome duplication or complete trisomy, caused usually by a non-disjunction during meiosis. When you analyze the cardiogram in this condition, you will observe triplication of chromosome number 21, and this extra genetic material is responsible for the various clinical features characteristic of the condition, namely things like fissured tongue, macroglossia, ankyloglossia, a high arched palate, malocclusions, problems with the gastrointestinal and cardiovascular systems, mental retardation, and the risk for developing tumors and tumor-like lesions. I'm sure you are all screaming out loud the diagnosis for this condition. Down's trisomy 21 syndrome, the most common chromosomal disorder, and these patients have very characteristic craniofacial features or facies that more often than not gives the diagnosis away. In Whitcomb's disease, the partial duplication event also results in extra genetic material that leads to an altered expression of certain candidate genes acetyl mericans, and the outcome of which is an uncontrolled proliferation of epithelial cells with premature keratinizations, or dyskeratosis, manifesting as thick white oral and epibulbal gelatinous plaques of tissue with dilated conjunctival vessels. The full nomenclature, hereditary benign intraepithelial dyskeratosis, is a very fitting description of the disorder. But now you have learned that it can also be named as 4q35 duplication syndrome or partial trisomy 4q35 syndrome, though these are not very common terms you'll come across in the literature. With that said, missense mutations in another gene, the NLRP1, has been found to demonstrate similar mucosal lesions as Waitkoff's disease. Now, that brings us to the histopathology of Waitkoff's, which typically reveals a benign increase in epithelial thickness with hyperparakeratosis, as well as numerous dyskeratotic cells which are particularly abundant in the superficial aspects of the hyperplastic epithelium, but may also occur deep within. These cells are dyskeratotic because they undergo premature individual keratinizations and appear rounded and isolated with a somewhat pycnotic nucleus and intense hypereosinophilic cytoplasm representing the intracellular keratinizations. Of course, these features will be more clearly apparent on cytologic preparations. Some of these cells appear to be phagocytosed by agent-sense normal cells, essentially defining a cell within a cell morphology, typical for this disorder. Overall, the basement membrane zone remains intact with no breach of the epithelial connective tissue barrier. The histology is the same for both ocular and oral lesions, but the ocular lesions especially may demonstrate moderate to intense subepithelial chronic inflammatory reaction. What about treatment of Waitkoff's disease? Well, as of now, there is no definitive treatment. The oral lesions, which by far are mostly symptomatic, do not require any intervention. Ocular involvement will require an ophthalmology consult where the lesions may be excised, but then recurrence is a norm invariably. Ocular lubricant and artificial tears may help to alleviate symptoms. Corneal keratoplasty may be done when the plaques begin to encroach on the cornea. Finally, as with all inheritable disorders, genetic counseling forms a crucial part of the management.